Okay, John, one, one. In the beginning was the Word.
That's how far we've got so far. Here it is, on mine, but there's not a period in this one, there's a comma. But it makes you feel like we're really going down the road, I'm not like you can hear anything.
All right, let me read a few notes from the last time, and then we'll proceed. In the beginning was the Word. And we said, therefore, the Word is the beginning. What do we find when we are in Christ, when we are in? So we're starting back at the very first. What do you find when you're in? You find the beginning. What do you find when you're in the beginning? You find the Word. In the beginning was the Word. When you go back to the beginning, there's nothing but the Word. You cannot go back beyond the beginning. There's nothing that precedes the Word, and don't ever forget that. There's nothing that precedes the Word. You are born again of incorruptible seed by the Word of God. The Word is the seed. The Word is the thing that causes you to have faith to believe. So you cannot go back beyond the beginning. There's nothing that precedes the Word. For you to have a beginning, you must be found in the Word. There's nothing there except in the beginning God. Genesis 1:1, in the beginning was the Word. John. You can't begin until you get in the Word. If we don't understand from the beginning, then we'll miss all the way down. If we start wrong, then we end wrong. Correct the problem, we must start back at the beginning, working to straighten out the things that branch from there. Don't build on the wrong foundation. So we said you must know the Word, or you must recognize that the Word is foundation. And that any other area that you give yourself to, ministry, children, this, that, whatever, is wrong. You can't do your children any good unless you're building on the Word. Unless you're building on the Word. You can't, I use this as an example. Once the Lord showed it to me, and I believe it to be true. I was in Bible school, and I was all busy, and I was doing this, and I was working, and I was helping, and I was doing all this stuff, and I had this gnawing feeling that I hadn't been in the Word for a while, and I was too busy to do the Word. And the Lord gave me a picture of somebody who was had leprosy, and that everything I touched, this slime of leprosy was left all. That's the picture the Lord gave me. He said, this is the work you're doing. That was my response. Oh, it's like everything I touched. But, I know a lot of people, Robert tells him, well, we're saving people, this and that. I mean, you name off all these ministries and stuff. But they say, well, it's really important. I say that if it doesn't come from the Word, it doesn't come from the original. It doesn't come from the seed. And therefore, it may be good, but good is off of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. God said, don't eat off of it. It's not off the tree of life. So, all right, so now we want to talk about, more specifically, this word, Word. In the Greek, it is the word logos, or however you want to pronounce it, logos, or logos, or laogos, I don't know how you want to pronounce it. It is spelled L-O-G-O-S. Logos, or logos, wherever you want to put the emphasis on it, is this word right here, the Word, the Logos. So, the Word, in the beginning was the Word. The Word is a further explanation of the generic term God described in Genesis 1:1. We start the very first chapter, the very first verse of the Old Testament. It says, in the beginning, God. Right? In the beginning, God. That's the Old Testament. This is the New Testament. In the beginning was the Word. And so that's why I wrote the Word is a further explanation of this generic term, God, described in Genesis 1:1. It helps you to understand further the God described in the Old Testament. So God obviously was in the beginning, meaning before creation, but as this thing began to be prepared in the heart of God. God was in the beginning before anything else came into existence, and he made Jesus the Logos for the work. He said, Jesus, you will be the work. You will be the Logos, okay? Now, we'll get into that in just a second, but the word Logos means the total thought and concept of God. The total thought and concept of God. And I've described this before. These big corporations, anybody, we have a logo. A logo is a picture of, in some form, that represents the whole corporation, from the business offices to the service department, right down to the da-da-da-da. The logo is the representative of the whole thing. To see the logo, you comprehend it all. This is that. You understand? And that's the word logo, we get the little drawing of whatever, you know. The word logo has come from this Greek word, logos, okay, which is the word. Jesus is the logo of God, except it is more than just a cute little picture of God. He is the total thought and concept of God. He is the total thought and concept of God. So that's why I say God was in the beginning before anything else came into existence, and he made Jesus the logo, so the total thought and concept. Jesus, and this is scriptural, Jesus dwells in the bosom of the Father, or the heart of the Father. This is not trying to describe to you location. Where is Jesus located? It's trying to spell out an intimacy between God the Father and God the Son. He dwells in the bosom of the Father. You want to know how important Jesus is to the Father? He can't get any closer to God. He dwells in the heart of the Father. Okay? That's the relationship between the Father and the Son. So he said, Son, you will be my logo. You will be my total thought and concept. And this is, you find the scripture that says, by Jesus, by him were all things made and created, visible and invisible. And he is before all things. Who is, then he starts talking about the church, who is the head of the church, the beginning, the firstborn. You know, you ought to read Colossians on this. I mean, this is it. He's it. And this was the plan from the very beginning. This was the original from which all others would come. So, it's ridiculous to ever think that you could please God without knowing the Logos, the Word. Because this is the image, it says in Hebrews 1:1, the express image of God. The express image of this person. Okay. So we say, okay, well, I'll modify my behavior and really bring pleasure to God. He's going, I'm not after... This isn't a behavior modification program we're dealing with here. I put my seed within you, Jesus Christ, and I don't want you to put a bushel over him, ignore him, and start to continue to live your life, you know, the way you did before, except for now you know you got a little helper in there called Jesus hidden under that bushel. That is the way it works. God placed his Son in us that Christ may be all and in all. Not that he might be a pretty darn good helper for all. Whoever says that. You see these bumper stickers, Jesus is my co-pilot, I always picture, kind of reaching over there and opening the door and kicking them out and putting Jesus, Jesus don't want to be nobody's co-pilot. He's Lord. He ain't semi-Lord or whatever. So, he is the pattern of God's mind. The pattern of God's mind. So have you ever noticed in the Bible, somebody asked Jesus a question or God in the Old Testament, and the answer would just be something totally off of what you expected. You go,
well, why did you do that? You know,
and I used to do that, and I'd go, I didn't understand it. I really, you know, I mean, I wanted to understand God. And I'd get all these weird answers and stuff, you know. I always think of the one that always messed with me. This Nicodemus came to Jesus by night, of course. He was slinking in there, like we talked about, because Nicodemus was a Pharisee. He didn't want to be caught actually rubbing elbows with Jesus. You know, like he actually thought he might be something. So he slips in by night and says, Nicodemus says, good master, you know, we know that you're God because nobody can do these miracles unless you were. And that you're a great teacher and all this stuff. And you know what? Jesus stops him in the middle of his thing and says, and Jesus answered him.
Yeah.
And said, you must be born again. If you read it, you ought to look at it real close. You just go, darn, you know, look, he's saying that, you know, you're going. And he said, but then Jesus goes on, you can't see the kingdom, you can't comprehend it until this seed, the incorruptible seed, being born again, of incorruptible seed by the word of God, which liveth. We ain't talking believing a few commandments. We're talking about the word that liveth. Right? The word that liveth. This is better than behavior modification. This is better than changing a few little things. This is the fullness, I said, the pattern of God's mind. And you'll never understand God's mind until you begin to understand. When God speaks, when God acts, when God moves, he has one picture, I think I might even have written it down. Let me see before I go too far. He's the pattern of God's mind. He is the total thought and concept of God. Christ is the law of God's mind. As if a mold in the mind of the Father, only Christ fits it. Okay, now, where are we, folks? In. See what I mean? Have we already forgotten? You know, we've only covered, what, 6 words here? See what I mean? We go, well, this is the only one. What hope is there for me? Or a million other things. Well, have we forgotten the first word? Have we gotten the first lesson? We go, well, I'm not going to understand the Bible. Forget the Bible. How are you going to understand 6 words? If you can't go with N and B, understanding the beginning and the word as the full pattern, no need spending time in the other sections. Spend the next 6 months or 6 years on 3 words and let the Holy Spirit speak to you and you'll be better off. That's that side of the hand person. Jerry, what's the
point? So you talked about how the mold of God's mind only Christ fits it, because I was searching in the first verse and finished up before you were sharing that, but the word beginning. And it's amazing when you search for the word beginning and all the things that relate to it, it actually comes to talking about boundaries and limits. And not in a space-time relationship, like bigger or smaller, but the type of shadow can be seen in the land of promise where the boundaries were very clearly laid out as to what was here. And in the beginning, you can understand where the beginning is, there's a boundary or there's a limit or boundaries to in a certain realm, and that there's no one bleeding over. That becomes a very secure thing, a very stable thing. You understand there's this place that it's at, and that it's no other place. Like the word is only found in the beginning. It's not found anywhere else. You're not going to find it anywhere else. So in the beginning to know the word. And that's very, that's not scary, and that's not, well, like if somebody who's trying to attain to it, but in reality, it's very secure, very stable, because you are right on the inside of the
word. But it sounds so profound.
Yeah.
And of course, to be who he is would have to be profound. But the scriptures say, be not removed from the simplicity that is in Christ. And yet we go, well, I don't understand it. I've been working hard for it. Or, you know, I mean, I hear these statements all the time. I've been trying. You go, trying what? You don't believe, you know, Are you believing or, you know, are you trying to believe? Are you working to be something or are you accepting what is? Do you see what I'm talking about? And so to say those things, you just go, you're not in the beginning. You know, you may be at the beginning, but you're not in it. And so, I was thinking, you know, if Jesus, if the Word, as the Word, He is the pattern of God's mind, He is the mold, then you're either measured in Christ or by Christ. You'll either be one day measured by Him or you'll be measured in Him. And to understand that, you have to read Ephesians 4, I think it's verse 13, where it talks about, till we all come to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Folks, what is the fullness of Christ? Anybody? The new man. The new man is the fullness of Christ. The resurrected Christ. Till we all come unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. So you're either measured in Him. This will help you to understand, I forget what chapter it is now, the book of Ezekiel, where the man who goes out and he begins to measure the New Jerusalem temple, okay, the millennial temple, the one after this is all over with, and we're with the Lord, he begins to measure the temple, and he measures the lengths and the heights, and you go, what is this? What is the waste of time knowing how wide the door is, and how this and that? I'll tell you why. Because first of all, the rod by which the Holy Spirit is measuring out this thing is Christ. Second of all, the building is Christ, the temple is Christ, you and me, fitly joined together. And third, it is all measured as one, but it each must fit together. And that's what he's trying to do now. Okay? And so, you know, the deal is, you'll either be measured in Christ and counted as a part, as you are fitly joined together, or you'll be measured by Christ as you stand there, and Christ in all his glory on the throne, and you're standing there going, you know, Hackett, you're out of here. If it's you and him, you ain't got a chance. But if it's you in him, and guess where you are located? Oh, by the way, you are in Christ. That's where the Holy Spirit placed you. You say, well, you know, cool, I don't understand it. I don't have it. You're still in Christ. And if you know, pure in heart will see God, those with pure motives will see the Lord. There's no question about it. Jesus is right. They will. And those who want their own stature and want to be something and measure themselves by everybody else, you know, are ready for a big fall. And I would hope you get your big fall down here. Because if you don't get it straight when you start being measured by Christ, it's going to be too late. You are not going to measure up, and man, and God ain't going to take any excuses. You ain't going to be able to sweet talk him. You ain't going to be able to fake him out. You ain't going to be able to, you know what I mean? I mean, it's going to be a big deal, and I would say, you know, let's get after it now. You know, I don't measure up. It's obvious I don't. I get it. Oh, God, help me. And then he'll say, okay, I'll help you by teaching you what I have done at the cross. The resurrection. And then you'll grab it with all you got. You'll embrace it. You want to know where faith comes from? When you begin to see how yucky you are and what he says you are in him, you'll hold on to it because you truly, truly, truly know how bad you are. You'll love the truth. If you don't, the truth will, you know, it won't motivate you, won't drive you to word, or won't, you know. And if every once in a while you go, well, it's my duty as a Christian, I probably should read this thing every once in a while. It's not going to be your life. being, B-E-I-N-G, being born again, not having once been born again, being born again by incorruptible seed, by the word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. Okay, so only by seeing the way the Father does can we know his Son the way he should be known. Turn with me to Hebrews chapter 1. We'll read that.
That's why he's called
The Word.
The Word.
The Word.
Like there's the beginning.
The Word.
Not the words, not a bunch of words, but the Word.
Jesus didn't come speaking words, but came as the Word of another.
He came as the Word of the Father.
He didn't minister words, he ministered as the Word.
The thought, complete thought concept of God.
Now, yeah, he spoke words. But his words are absolutely useless if they did not come from the Word of the Father. The source. He could claim no work of his own, for he was that work. He was what the Father sent. I've often said, he didn't come to bring a message from God. He came as the message of God. Jesus is the message of God. He's not just a messenger of God. He's the message. Jesus never said anything on the Mount of Transfiguration. Remember when he was there, he never said anything on the Mount of Transfiguration, but stood there as the Word of the Father. And so the Father said, God spoke when they were on the Mount of Transfiguration, and he spoke, and he said, this is my Son, hear ye him. But he never said anything. In fact, really, if you look at it, all he ever said was, well, let us go down from here.
Well, I heard that.
Word, that's not what it meant. Was, this is my Son, hear him. Let's come down from the mount now. Okay, we'll do what, he's saying, this is my Son who is the Word. He didn't say, hear his words. He said, hear ye him. Because he's the Word. Many have not heard the Word. Most are motivated by the words, the scriptures. More than they are the word themselves. Now, the words came from the word. To understand the words, you have to understand the word, the source from which they came. The Word is the expression of God and the expressed image of God. There are many preachers who are unable to express themselves adequately, though they preach many words in the course of an hour. And I know what that's like. But God was able to express himself totally using only one word. Jesus, the person. He said all he had to say when he sent Jesus. That's what he had. That's what he's got to say. This is so hard. He only said one word. The Word is preeminent. In the beginning was the Word. The Word in the beginning. Not in the beginning is the prayer, or the pray service, or the taking care of babies, or, in the beginning was the Word. The Word is preeminent. We don't make it preeminent. It's preeminent. It is preeminent. The greatness of the Word is not you putting him first. Its greatness is not derived from man declaring the Word. If it doesn't affect, it's still preeminent. Preach it, it doesn't affect anybody. The Word is still preeminent. And will we prove it as such? So the question isn't, or the situation isn't, we make the Word great by believing it or following it. It's great. The best that we can do is conform to it. You can find it as the church to conform to it. And there is nothing that is ours in Christ that we do not possess by the Word. The truth that we're found in Christ was first declared unto us by the Word. We could have never known even the truth that we're in Christ, or the truth that we can be saved. Except the living Word himself, which became the written Word, which we have believed. The Word is first. The Word is
word has power. The word of God is quick and powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword, able to divide soul from spirit and flesh, joint from marrow. Spirit, so able to divide spirit, soul, and body. Okay, let's talk about the word of God and direction. Until we truly comprehended the word, we may have guidelines, but we do not truly have direction. I feel like the Lord specifically had me say it that way, write it down that way. The law, the Ten Commandments, gives you guidelines. Gives you a running board. Okay? But that's not true direction. The word gives you direction. And that's why I said, until we've truly comprehended the word, we may have the scriptures, and the scriptures may give us guidelines, but we don't truly have direction. From the beginning, only in the word can we find direction. How many places do you go for direction in a time of crisis? We usually go to another person during the crisis. We are closer to another person than to the word. Right? We sit in Christ and are motivated by everything but the word. If I'm trying to make a decision for my life, I can only do it after looking at Him who is my life. Is that right or wrong? We're looking at everything else but Him. Right? We'll get into that even more in this next section. Yes. Right. So if I'm trying to make a decision for my life, I can only do it after looking at Him who is my life. You have no true direction until you're looking in the face of Jesus. Now, some may understand what I'm saying, some may not, but I know there have been times when I've gotten what I consider direction, what I should do, but I had not really looked into the face of Jesus. And do you know that you can know the right thing to do it, still it not be right? You can know the right thing to do and do it and still it not be right because your spirit is wrong. The spirit which is done. Yeah, okay, I know it's my turn to clean the bathtub. You know, I'll clean it. And nobody will know that I hate their guts for this, but you know, at least I did the right thing. I went in there and I cleaned it. Bless God, I hope they choke on. Or, for me, it's way less than that. I mean, it's more or less, I just know the difference between me and the Lord. I know the difference between, you know, figuring out or somebody handing you a piece of paper and saying, go two blocks and turn left, or seeing the face of the Lord to go two blocks and turn left. That's the only way I know how to put it. I don't know how to put it any other way. I can just tell you that when I've seen the Lord, there ain't nothing can harm me. There's nothing that can harm me. You can put nails in me and I'll say, forgive me, Father. When you see the Lord, that doesn't mean everything's rosy and you're going, oh, I just love it. I don't mean that you wouldn't die on a cross. I mean, I'm not talking about that kind of harm. I'm talking about your spirit is such that they can't say anything that's going to offend you or do anything because you have the Lamb spirit. And that spirit is ready to die for them. And the very proof that they need dying for is the attitude and actions that they're taking against you. So that's the necessity of somebody having the spirit of the Lamb, the spirit of Christ. The spirit of Christ and Him crucified. They are living proof that there is a need for Christ, the the Word made flesh. And so you go, praise God for this opportunity. You lay down your life. When you haven't seen Jesus, try that little trick. When somebody says, well, brother, you just need to lay down your life. Try. You want to take that little portion of Scripture, rip it out into a little ball, shove it up there. A pencil and a hammer and like lodge it in the brain. Thank you for that little tidbit of information that I need to lay down my life. The Spirit, which is the living Word, is everything. Not the directions or the guidelines that we are to follow, and this is why it's useless on one hand to make rules. You make rules for the ungodly. You know what I mean? The rules are for the lawbreakers. The rules aren't for those who live in the Spirit of the thing. They don't need those rules. They go the second mile beyond those rules. And those rules aren't anything. The rules, you know, I'm getting this from Scripture, you realize. Timothy.
I was just thinking in my own mind, you know, like in the past, there's a, say it's a situation of a fence, and you can go, and sometimes the Holy Spirit, you pray about this, the Holy Spirit says, you need to go and do this, you know. So, okay, the Holy Spirit said, I need to go do this. All right, that's one way to do it. Then the second way is the Word says to go to make this right. It says very clearly, so I follow the Word. Or the third way is to go because the Spirit of Christ in you is giving you brokenness.
Absolutely.
And you, they're all three are right.
Sure, that's right.
But especially there's a difference between being, to me, anyway, being led of the Spirit and being led of the Spirit of Christ. Because you can be led of the Spirit, not led of the Spirit of Christ.
Right.
And, you know, it's like He directs you to do certain things, but then you don't really go in the Spirit of His nature.
I think we've all experienced that probably to some degree where we were used with God, whether in church service or ministry or something, and at the same time we're being used with God, we feel pride.
Yeah.
I think most of us have experienced that. And haven't you kind of gone, yeah, it's kind of a weird combo here. You know, I'm being used with God. It's not me, it's God, and yet I'm feeling pride over this, you know? But that is an example of operating by the Holy Spirit, but not by the Spirit of Christ. And, you know, I mean, I think operating by the Holy Spirit is way better than just saying, the heck with you, I don't want to be used. You know what I mean? So I think that's good. I mean, but I know that God has a logo that He wants us all to conform to, the logo. That's the real deal. You know, if you only did three things in your life that were of God, but the rest of the time it was the Spirit of Christ, even though you didn't do these great things led by the Holy Spirit, I just, you know, we're talking on one hand either mansions or pleasing the heart of the Father. And, you know, I know some people are going, you know, they were greedy in this life, and now they're greedy after stuff in heaven. You know, they had covetousness, you know, and they wanted gold down here, and now they got saved. And go, oh, I want to lay mine up in heaven. You know, I feel that the preacher wants, you know, he wanted all the rewards he could get, you know. And rewards, you know. And, you know, if I let you work with me, will you give me 20% of your reward? Take 100%. Yeah! 100%! Cool! You know, you just go, you know, if I had 200%, I'd give it to you. I'm, you know, the Father's heart is pleased with you doing what you're doing because you do it as a son of God. That's all the pleasure you're after. You know, and, you know, if you stand before God, and that guy's standing there, and God the Father goes, okay, here's the reward.
that guy, and you can see the look in their father's eyes that says, "Oh, but I'm pleased with you as my son." I guarantee you, that's all that's really going to really matter. You go, "Well, I'm going to get his boy." Is there somebody else saying, "Greg?"
Those are true on that level.
We're not putting those down, are we?
No, it's true on that level. Actually, it's probably good that you do that and nothing else. But
It's all packed in that seat.
Yeah, exactly.
The seat has it all.
Yeah.
I mean, it has the bark, it has the tree limbs, it has the leaves, it has the fruit, it has the sap, it has the, it's got the roots, it's got everything. It's got the right colors, it's got the right fragrances. You know, and we're trying to copy all that, and we'll never copy it all. I mean, it's like a judgment that something's going to drop. But if you get that seed in there, then it's all going to come out. And see, this, that, it's funny, this principle of the Logos, the seed, the word as seed, you know, and it does talk about the word as incorruptible seed. That concept was a biggie for me. It helped me over a huge hump when I actually realized that. Many of you that's been around any length of time has heard me make this comment about the seed. In the seed is, you know, and I start naming off all these things. I say that, and I don't just have a good memory. There's a reality there that greatly affected me, because before that time, before I'd really seen the word as seed and as incorruptible seed, I saw it as letter and a whole bunch of stuff that I had to figure out and do right. And it was real hard. And I was real sincere. And I was doing the best I could. And I kept messing up, and I felt bad more than I felt good. You know. Then when I realized that I had already received the word, the incorruptible seed, that all I needed to do was let, as it were, this thing grow. Now, I didn't know fully what that meant, but if I truly received it, I believed it would grow. And as it grew, it has all the elements that I need. All the fruit, all the everything that I'm going to need, it's God. And it is the total thought concept of God. It's what God had in mind, and I was created to carry or bear that. And so it just... You know, only when you see that by the Holy Spirit, but when I saw it by the Holy Spirit, and I went, I mean, it was like, oh, glory to God. I mean, it just took all this weight off. It was just tremendous. And so, ever since then, I have said, you know, let's give the word preeminence. You know, and somebody says, well, okay, I'll read the Bible every day. Well, that's good. That's still not really what I'm saying. You know, I think you could go weeks, maybe, even, without reading the word at all and still give the word preeminence. Because the word is the original seed. The Logos, the total thought concept of God. Now, you know, let's put it not as seed, but as bread. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. So let's keep in the scriptures. Right? See, because the word isn't just seed, it's also bread, it's also a lot of other things.
Like I said, I had to watch the property, and so that's really the reason we use the scriptures, being so quiet, you know, just spend time with those around. And I pulled out my Bible, and I started hearing from the Lord, and he was teaching them, but I never got a chance to open my Bible.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Before you got a chance, you started, and that was it. I mean, I never opened my Bible all day. But boy, I tell you what, I felt like I got the word that day, and I heard the Lord and felt like I saw the Lord that he was.
I'll tell you what happens to me a lot is the Holy Spirit starts sharing something with me, and I have to grab my Bible and look it up. It's not necessarily scriptures, but sometimes it is scriptures, and I want to see exactly what it says here. In other words, we're having this fellowship. This happened today, as a matter of fact. We're having this fellowship, and all of a sudden I go, oh, and where's my Bible? You know what I mean? I'm in the Word, not in the Scriptures.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't, let me just explain this. If it doesn't line up with the Scriptures, you got a real problem. We're not talking some sort of, just to make sure, we're not talking extra-biblical revelation. Or some sort of weird, gosh, you got to watch everyone, don't you? You know, we're talking... What's true, it ain't going to go outside of this. So, you know, and he ain't going to be able to talk to you and then lead you to scriptures you don't know. You need to know the scriptures. And we'll get into that more as we go, but I mean, the truth is you need to know the scriptures before you know the word. Okay. But we'll also see that in one sense, I'm saying 50,000 times, in one sense, the word and the scriptures are the same. You should, and in one sense, you should not separate them.
because to separate them can be dangerous, and this is where people get into extra biblical theology and all this kind of stuff. So the word as the logos is huge. It is beyond, it's somewhere in my notes I put, the word was before the scriptures. Well, obviously, but this is God's guidelines to know the word. And so this is where we go to search the scriptures so that we can know Christ. Okay?
Well, I'm telling you, I was sure.